say justice is blind, and our next guest is proof of that in every sense, making US history as the first blind judge appointed to a state Supreme Court. Each day, Richard Bernstein has to memorise countless pages of court cases and other documents. He's dedicated his entire life to helping other people with disabilities, and one way he does that is by showing that blindness is not an obstacle. He even runs marathons. Whoa. He's finished 18 of them so far. Yeah. Justice Richard Bernstein is visiting Australia, and he's our special guest on Studio 10.
Thank you. I just have to say, I love Australia. I just want you guys to know.
You don't have to say it.
I love it. And the people here are so friendly and so warm and so kind. And there's just this genuine enthusiasm that Australians have that I just hope you know that you live in a wonderful country. And I really feel blessed to be your guest and to be with you.
So. Let's leave it there.
Thank you. We love it. Australians love it when Americans say how much they love Australia. And also, thanks for World War II. We really appreciate it.
People are so friendly, though. And there's a warmth here that you just don't find in too many other places. And I just really enjoy being here.
I see. I've seen a lot of Judge Judy, and you are very nice compared to her. She's pretty cranky.
Well, you know what? Actually, really good judges should always be compassionate and kind. And what's interesting is that I've always believed that the best judges are the ones who face the biggest struggles or hardships or difficulties in their life, because they're able to empathize and understand and connect with the struggles and challenges and hardships that real people face on a daily basis. I mean, if you're making a decision that's going to affect somebody's life, the more struggle you've gone through, the more you can empathize with the issues that they're contending with.
You've obviously struggled more than most. You have a disability, or whatever you want to call it, that that most people think is just sort of unfathomable. How do you, and I know another very famous lawyer here in Australia who's also blind, just take us through the practicalities of how you memorise these huge swathes of judgment. You must memorise huge amounts of case law, huge amounts of legal precedent. How do you do it?
Well, the key is, though, is that you have to factor in, if it takes you 1 hour, it takes me five.
Wow.
So it's a 1-to-5 ratio for me to do my work.
Do you sleep?
I'm sorry? Not really. But you know what it is? I'm just very passionate about what I do, and I feel very blessed to be given the life that I've been given.
Does someone read the yes. information to you, or do you have it on Audible?
No, you have to have it read, because you have to have questions and discussions with your clerks.
Wow.
So the way it works is every Wednesday, we have something called conference. And there are 26 cases on the conference agenda. So when you have that many cases, what happens is people think, oh, can you put it in Braille? Well, you can't Braille it because there's too much material. Like, if you have a murder case, that's like a month case, so you can't put it into Braille because it's just too voluminous. Mm. And then people say, well, what about using a computer? Can you use technology? That doesn't work either, because if you're listening to your headset, you can't hear the other six justices, so you're not participating.
Oh,
so what I actually do is I memorize all 26 cases.
Yes.
And the way it works, I know it sounds crazy, but it really works, because what happens is that I memorize the different areas and components of law that are relevant, and then what they'll do is they read the procedural case history of each case. So they'll say, okay, now we're on case 18. And when I hear the procedural case history, that's my mental trigger, and I can recall the case in its entirety. And, you know, when you have a case that you care about, you then have to persuade six other justices that they should vote with you. So you have to handle all the questions that are going to come in from all the other judges to make your argument. And at the end of the day, it doesn't matter if you're blind. These are people's whole lives. I mean, you have people who are facing life in prison without parole.
Yeah.
So if you're blind or not, it doesn't matter. If you believe in something, you have to get the job done, because people are counting on you.
But Richard, is it true that, you know, when you finished law school or were at law school and you went for interviews for a job, you got no's, pretty much rejections across the board?
Oh, totally. I'm so used to that. I just got to be honest. Like, when you get rejected as much as I do, you really just become... Oh, no problem. You really just become, like, totally, like, you just get used to it. So I went on 65 interviews and didn't get a single call back. But the greatest thing about life, and I really believe this, I love my state, the great state of Michigan, because in our positions, we have to get elected to serve in our positions.
Yeah.
And so what's great is there's 11 million people in my state. And what's exciting is that those folks said that we want somebody with a severe disability to represent us on the bench. And I think that says a lot about how times are changing, where people with disabilities are now coming out of the shadows and are not just integrating on an equal basis, but we're now given an opportunity to serve in a position where we can make decisions that affect the lives of able-bodied people. And for the voters of Michigan to extend that opportunity is something I'm grateful for and am not going to let them down. And that's why I work 15 hours a day, because you don't want to disappoint folks that gave you an opportunity to do something like this.
I'm the same, 15 hours a day. What are you preparing?
The show feels like it's 15 hours, that's for
you
sure.
You guys have a great show, though. Aww. I mean, there's such a nice energy on the studio. Like, if the people at home could realize, these are wonderful people.
Aww.
And they should just know that you guys are a lot of fun to spend time with.
You've just made the promo. Yeah.
About you, Richard, is your positivity, it's infectious here, but so many people struggle with, you know, and they've got everything going for them and they don't have the barriers you have in front. You need to be a life coach to explain how to, you know, overcome all those sorts of traits. You know, if you have everything going for you and you're feeling negative, how do you...
But I think that's okay. And I think the way I approach it is that everybody has their own struggles and their own issues. And I think that's completely okay. And I think the issue with me is, I think when you go through life, it's not always about being happy. Life isn't about always smiling and being joyous. I think for me, it's about having a sense of purpose, a sense of mission, a sense of knowing that you're here for something bigger than yourself. And I think if you live your life with that sense of duty and that sense of passion, then what they always say is an easy life does not always correspond to a good one.
Yeah.
But often if you have some challenge and you have that difficulty, it really gives you that sense of focus to know that, you know, ultimately you're sent here for something bigger than yourself. And why else do we have life experience but to use them to impact the lives of those that we're able to serve?
So well said. Now, Justice Richard Bernstein, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you for having me.